I'll take a full 15 minutes, we'll see how it goes. If the eyes begin to glaze over, it's time for me to get another cup of coffee. That's your eyes, not mine. Thank you for inviting me. This is one in a long series of tours. We've had two in Glasgow so far, one in Edinburgh, we're in South Lanarkshire today. We're in Fleece, Garden Valley. Sunday gives us the joys of travelling first to Fraserburgh and then to Elgin for two Hustings on the same day. It's a fantastic thing to be doing, particularly for the new members where they can see democracy in action. And one of the things that struck me is a number of the people who've come from the Labour Party recently are quite amazed at the level of internal democracy the SNP has, and that votes will be granted, that you can stand up and ask your question. You don't have to have been a member of the committee for 5 years for the chairman maybe to call you, and all the other anecdotes we're hearing about the inner workings of other political parties. And we saw how some of the parties worked this week. Westminster was extraordinary. We had, on Monday, the publication of the command paper on devolution. We had a seven-hour debate on devolution on Tuesday. We had Scottish questions on Wednesday. And of course that was topped off by Gordon Brown's heroic debate on devolution last night. But the problem is, none of that's actually true. We had a command paper which suggests a devolution of perhaps 30% of Scotland's revenue base, less than half the revenue requirements of the Scottish Parliament. That is not serious devolution. That is not in the extensive new powers David Cameron promised. That certainly isn't the closest thing to a federal state within 1 to 2 years that Gordon Brown himself offered. And then, of course, Wednesday's Scottish Questions was like nothing had happened. It was the usual anti-SNP, anti-Scottish Parliament nonsense, particularly from Alistair Carmichael. And then the debate last night with Gordon Brown was just absolutely self-indulgent. I'm not surprised that the Dundee Courier have said this week that his intervention since the referendum has been divisive. I think we can just take out intervention since the referendum and stick to divisive full stop, but that's another matter entirely. So Westminster hasn't changed. It's like nothing has happened. The salt tyre that flew over Downing Street has been put back in its box, as has Westminster politicians' attitudes to Scotland. The first PMQs since the referendum, the Prime Minister did not mention Scotland once. The debate on Tuesday, a seven-hour debate, the SNP had 6 minutes out of 7 hours. This was a debate hijacked by English votes for English laws. And the three signatories of the vow, Clegg, Cameron and Miliband, were all absent. You know, one would have thought, having seen us take the UK so close to the brink, that they might now, after 1.6 million people had voted yes, at least, at the very least, have shown some respect to Scotland. Instead, it's lip service, it's tokenism, and within a week, it was gone. That's what we're facing. That's why we were campaigning for independence. And that's why we're still campaigning for independence. Description I've given is just so incredibly different to what we've seen in the last 2 years, particularly the 18th of September. Tens of thousands of yes activists knocking on the doors of over a million identified independent supporters, delivering a 45% vote for yes, with the entire weight of the UK sent against us to deliver a no vote. But no one can deny the result overall. It's clear for all to see, and we should not deny it. Nor, however, can we deny the incredible enthusiasm and energy that the Yes campaign brought, re-energising, revitalising politics in every single corner of the country, and witnessed since then by this incredible rise in the membership of the SNP and, to be fair, the other Yes-supporting parties. What I'm saying in my pitch to be the deputy leader of the party, and its deputy leader of the party, not deputy first minister, is that we need to keep that yes campaign together somehow in order to keep the campaigning zeal going forward so that we can return the largest number of independent supporting MPs at next year's election. That's the next challenge we face. And why is that important? Because Westminster recognises only one thing: raw power counted by the number of MPs the parties have. That's it. Nothing else, no subtlety, raw power. And if we're to force them to deliver to their promise, if we're to hold their feet to the fire to deliver on their vow, then we need to keep the campaigning energy of the Yes campaign intact to deliver next year. Now, I'm sure there'll be many, many of the wonderful, talented people who emerge from the Yes campaign who will stand at next year's election. But I'm equally certain that the SNP are the main vehicle for us. With 80,000 members, it's a turbocharged vehicle to deliver gains next year. I think if we get this right, and I'm sure we will return the largest number of SNP MPs to Westminster next year, and we'll force Westminster to deliver what it said it would do, which is devo max. And remember this, 25% of those who voted no did so with the best of intentions to get maximum devolution. That means everything apart from defence and foreign affairs. It is that we will hold Westminster to. You see, we expect them to disappoint us, but when they start to disappoint substantial numbers of people who voted no, then there's a game changer for what happens on the road to independence. But we need to win next year first. I think it's important that the deputy leader of the party takes a key role in keeping the Yes campaign or the independence movement together in whatever guise. I won't be prescriptive. The SNP alone cannot determine this. We've got to be respectful of all our partners, other parties and organisations. But let's keep working in the same direction. Many, many, many people in the campaign and in the public want that to happen. What do we also say, because this is a Hustings for the deputy leader of the party, is there are some other things I'd like to see done. I think the party functions. We can see the party function. We know that we've been able to win, you know, not least in the last Scottish parliamentary election. But we need to step up the training at local level for office bearers and in particular organisers to make our new members feel welcome and to get the best out of all our members, new and old. I'd like to see the huge talents we now have involved in policy making. I'd like to see regional and national assemblies, the policy formulation part of the party, to use the experience and the talent we now do at a regional level. That would allow far more people to have an input. And I'd like to see a quarterly national council, that's the governing structure of the body, out with conference. I'd like to see that turn from 200 or 300 people to something closer to spring conference, 1,000 or 1,500 people, so that some of the incredible people we've met over the last year can have an input at a national level. And I think if we make those modest changes, we can strengthen the party locally, regionally and nationally, which puts us in a brilliant place to move forward 2015 and beyond. But I want to end, I'm not going to take the full 50 minutes unless I have, of course. I want to end by talking about some of the politics. Because it's where we are now will determine some of what we see and do over the next few months. Willie Rennie, who partly is the leader of the Liberal Democrats, he said the lust for independence may tear the SNP apart. And I think the headline writer in the Scotsman meant to say the desire for independence will see the SNP go from strength to strength. But setting that aside for a moment, only a politician who thinks keeping the principle is a bad thing could have said that. We will stick to our principle of independence, and he will find out what happens to a political party which abandons its principles at the election next year. Yeah. The final thing that I want to say in terms of the politics of where we are is what Ed Miliband said 2 weeks ago. He said that next year's Scottish election, next year's election, will not all be about new powers for Scotland. I think the message we should be putting out to the public and to our Labour friends, Edmund Laband is wrong. The general election in Scotland next year will only be about new powers for Scotland. And with 80,000 members of the SNP, keeping the Yes campaign intact, we can deliver what we need in terms of seats in Westminster to get those powers. And then when the time comes, whether they betray no voters, whether there's an in-out referendum on Europe driven by Nigel Farage, whatever the game changer is, we will be ready, waiting, able, fully organised. We're not going anywhere. The cause of independence is not dead. To get 45% in the first time of asking was interesting. When the seventh wave crashes on the shore, it will be substantially more than that. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening. I was nearly finished. This has been a fantastic experience. All the Hustings are big numbers across the country. Both the other candidates, Keith and Angela, are first class. I think you will find this is the politest internal contest anyone's ever been involved in. But if you've got a heart in you at all, vote for me. Thank you very much.